to the Startup Grind.
Great to have you. I'm glad you could come out tonight. And in spite of the rain, everyone else made it. I was hoping everyone would make it in spite of the rain. Yeah. But look at pretty good turnout.
Uber works here.
Yeah.
Netherlands is only Amsterdam.
Yeah, so we usually like to start off with a little bit of background information to understand a little bit more about where you came from. Were you born? Where were you born? Where do you come from?
Antwerp, Belgium. We're very proud.
So big city life.
Well, I left, so not that really. But I love Belgium.
Yeah.
Startup scene is less than the Netherlands, partially why we moved head offices to the Netherlands. Mm-hmm. Born and raised in Antwerp, was in the city center. My parents, I guess, just came with a suitcase and $100. They were from the Soviet Union. Mm-hmm. That collapsed. 91, they left. Came to Belgium. I was born in 93 then. And so I'm completely Belgian. Don't know anything else. I know the language, so that's good. And since there, they kind of, well, when you don't have anything, the kind of only option is to be an entrepreneur. So I guess I only saw that lifestyle, mm-hmm. but it wasn't called
from your parents.
Yeah, it wasn't called entrepreneurship.
Of course.
My parents told me to always become a lawyer, so I studied law. I just followed that pattern. I was very curious, asking a lot of questions. So I wanted to study law because I wanted to know everything. My reasoning to study law was to say that if I would ever have a car accident, that was the movie playing in my head. If I ever had a car accident, you always had a guy come out and say, "I'm going to sue you." And then I wanted to say, "No, you're not." It's like, you can't. So that was my reasoning behind it. And my parents became big at 17 years old. It kind of separated. They had a divorce. It got a little bit messy, but to say it really nicely, I didn't fit it into the plans of both parents. Mm. So I kind of went on my own. Luckily, I had skipped my last year. I jumped in the sense that I finished, graduated early. So I was already in university when that happened. And I was suddenly left 17 years old, which is not very nice in Belgium because you don't have rights. You kind of learn it, knowing a minor doesn't have rights, but I actually experienced it. It means going to a police station, them not wanting to accept your written review because you're a minor, going to an institution, them not wanting to take your statement for support, for instance. So I was stuck with that position, and what do you do? So from 17 years old, I kind of, what they now say in a very creative and nice way, hustled, which sounds nicer than what it is. And I guess I ended up in entrepreneurship, founding companies. Mostly was I wanted to fund my law school. I couldn't believe that because of the misfortune that I had, suddenly my law school dream would have stopped. So that's kind of how I ended up. I ended up doing seven or eight jobs. Mm-hmm. And then my mentor told me, I was overstressed, crazily overstressed. And my mentor told me, you have to find a way where you do those seven or eight jobs and make more money, but do less. That's all he said. And I was like, what? And funnily enough, 3 months later, I started Lightning Video Editors, which is the main company in the video marketing that we do for multinationals. And that funded me through law school. But there was a lot of ups and downs, a lot of jobs. Like I said, student jobs don't pay well. So, So that's the background story, I guess.
So backtracking just a little bit, when you were younger, when you were, say, 7 or 8 in school, were you already thinking about business, about work? I guess, like you said, you saw your parents' activity and what they were doing.
Yeah, for sure.
Were you already engaged in somehow? A lot of the typical is, selling candy or, some of the other speakers we had.
Yeah.
They were buying stuff from China and selling it to their friends and things like that. They always found some way.
I wasn't doing it. for the simple reason that every time I had an idea, my parents said no. Mm. Like, it was just, no, it doesn't happen. It was, like my dad used to say, a dictatorship. Focus on studies, which is actually very common in immigrant households. So every time I had an idea, hey, I want to go on the streets and go door to door because my friends are doing it, and like in the scouts, collecting money, and it got me really excited, and I couldn't do it, so I didn't do it. And then I think around, 11 years old, I discovered online secondhand shops,
right,
like secondhand.nl, like, I don't know what it is here. But and I realized that people were selling iPhones for like way cheaper, and I was like, what if I just buy an iPhone and sell dad an iPhone, and then I'm not breaking my parents' rules? And so I started flipping a lot of stuff. I got to luxury watches after a while, which was good. And then at 15 years old, at 13 years old, I got my first job. Working in a bar, which is really cool because I was 13. So I sampled all the, I probably shouldn't tell this, but I sampled all the drinks. And then at 15 years old, that's like the time when we all go clubbing and stuff in my school. Well, it's not 16 years old because that's the minimum drinking age, but we got in at 15. So I started spending quite some money, and my parents didn't want to give me money. So I needed to find a creative way to go out without spending money. So I started throwing club parties because now I got money from sponsors and everything, and I could go out. And I got VIP corners without doing anything. So that was my first real venture if I was small.
Mm.
But I wasn't like flipping candy in school. My parents would have punished me if I did that.
So your current company, Lightning Video Editors, you said you started that shortly after you finished high school.
Yeah.
How did you come across, or what was the idea behind that?
What was the idea? Well, the idea was I needed to find a thing that makes me more money than the 7 or 8 jobs. But realistically, what the thing was, I got into a community of people where I found my mentor. The mentor told me I needed to find a thing, and then I was brainstorming with him because at the time I was doing door-to-door sales, one of the jobs that I was doing, and I'd been promoted there kind of as an unofficial team leader where I was like coaching people in sales, and I thought, hey, all these people are like selling stuff online, maybe I'd do like a course and I sell that online, to which he replied, no, everybody's doing that, don't do that, it's horrible. So I was like, okay, if it's that bad, then I'll stay away from it. And I did. So the next thing on the list was I was traveling. I was taking pictures and videos of that. I was like, hey, I have a camera. Maybe I should do something with video. And then he says, well, it's a good market. At the time, it was a good market. Now it's overcrowded. It's a good market. It's competitive. If you make sure that you're better than the rest, and we have ways to be better than the rest, you could actually make something there. So when I was building it, it had to be something with video. I didn't know what it was going to be.
Mm.
But I knew that the number one problem in that industry is that everybody loves to film. Everybody hates to edit. So that's how we got to video editors, which is actually still in the name, and we barely do that. And it needed to sound cool. So I was like, hey, how about I just do lightning or something? It was like, there were a lot of names. It was like Zeus, yeah, video editors, or Greek mythology stuff. But we ended up with Lightning Video Editors. And we started doing video conferences, editing a lot, because I knew people in that industry. And it ended up to what we do now, which is video marketing for multinationals, because we take all those videos and create a funnel behind it, make sure that it converts, and so it's all the more detailed stuff, the technical stuff that...
So it's actually sort of pivoted from the original concept to something...
Yeah, yeah. But in the name, it's still reflected. Yeah. Where we were... Originally, I was walking around with other camera guys, because I was hiring camera guys. I wasn't doing it myself.
Mm-hmm.
And we were walking around filming conferences to now. Sometimes we still do it. We filmed South by Southwest Update in Amsterdam, so that was a cool thing. But we usually do more of the technical stuff because it's not less competition, but if you gather a lot of data from a lot of videos, you have a step up that others don't have. Unless you're a big media agency, like there's no competition. And even there's not really a competition because you have different data than I have. And I'm more focused on this target market, and I know these clients a little bit better than you, and so I have something that they want, and it becomes easier. And so I kind of started listening to my clients, mm-hmm. and I realized that they didn't really want the video part. They wanted what the video brought them, which is more sales. And how do I get them more sales? Not by making a video, but by creating the funnel behind it that actually leads to a video, that actually leads to converting that traffic. And that's listening. I just listened.
Okay. So, I mean, I was going to ask a question sort of, I guess it's related to the first part of your, of the company. Because a lot of founders here, a lot of startups, obviously they're looking to sell, they're starting a new company and they're looking for their customers. So how did it work for you? How did you find your first customers? How did you reach out in the first place, find out that it was a pain point that you could monetize, capitalize on top of? And then how did you start to reach out to customers in the early days?
Well, it was more of a different mindset. It was more of a mindset of instead of finding something new that I wasn't going to do with a law background, I'm not going to engineer suddenly something or code something. It was more like finding a viable market that already has money in it, mm-hmm. and then just beating the competition. It sounds really harsh, but like being better than the competition, especially in this industry, and this is actually a big thing that if somebody is listening and is a filmmaker, a lot of people in this industry, in the branding, video, the PR, they're very creative. They're the kind of types that you find at short film festivals, which that's where I was looking for editors. Mm-hmm. And that nails them because I'm very commercial because I want my clients are paying me money, so I want them to be happy with me. So I would always sacrifice the creative part as long as my client was happy up to a point because there's some things that I know convert better. Yeah. So I would tell them, don't do that. And if you do, it's on your own risk. But I would always listen to my client. I would adjust that. It's making the creative industry, I guess, nicer for the clients, which is what it should be, instead of putting my foot down and saying, no, this is how it should be, the video. And so I chose a market that had money in it. And I just started being better than the rest, to the point where now I was working with the best, and I could hire the best.
Okay. And what advice would you have for
get clients?
Well, for successful sales as a startup. As a startup, often you're not well known. Even if your product is better, maybe you're not very well known. So,
but a lot of people don't do sales.
That's exactly the question. What's the point? What's the key to sales?
I don't know. I have a feeling that most people get into startup life because it's nicer on that side, and they don't do sales. They create the product. They create the brand, and I'm part of that as well. Sometimes you catch me doing the branding where I totally shouldn't. But like initially when I got into my company, I needed food on the table. Mm. So everything I was doing was with in mind, like branding, it had to be premium so I could attract premium clients so that I could have food on the table because no sales is no food. And so when you're a startup, I have a feeling from the friends that I see, from the mentors that I see, actually we started investing a couple of months ago, from the investments that I see, the people that are hungry because they need the sale and they realize that that's their priority, like they'll get it. They'll start looking into their network. Everybody has 10 to 100 people in their network. And if you don't, like when I started, I didn't have that. I started getting a lot of jobs, and in all those jobs, you start meeting people,
right.
And they also have problems. And so you can have the job and externally also assist them with a video or with marketing. And where do you get that knowledge? On the internet, you go on Udemy, you go on YouTube, and like basic Facebook ads knowledge. Every company nowadays wants a Facebook ads expert, but they don't want to invest the time to go on YouTube or Udemy to actually learn how to create a Facebook ad campaign. Whereas you can just go on YouTube. You don't even have to go on Udemy. You go on YouTube, you see how to create a Facebook ads campaign. You go get a job in like 2-3 companies as like part-time, and you're like, and as you're talking with your boss, you're starting noticing probably that he has problems attracting clients, and then you'll say, hey, I can do Instagram ads for you, I can do Facebook ads for you, and there's your first client if you don't have any connections. Mm. If you have connections already, it makes it easier, because then you just ring up your blacklist book, and that's the stories of founders that they always say, which is like they have an idea, they call up some people, and then the first sale comes in. So then go through your black book and then just go every number cold calling. And this is also a thing that startups I noticed don't realize. The conversion rates are 2-4%. That's industry standard. Mm-hmm. On a landing page, if you can get 10-20%, you have a really good landing page. So knowing that those are the percentages, for every 100 people you contact, 2 or 4 will become clients. Then you know what you need to do. You need to contact 1,000 people, and every 100 you have to optimize. Because if you're not converting 2 or 4 at the 100 mark, that means you're doing something wrong. You get to the 200 mark, you haven't optimized still. Like, you have to optimize. When you get to 1,000, now you can say, cool, I got this many clients. Did I get to my 4% conversion rate? Then 4%, that's awesome. And every time I hear people talk, they say, hey, I can't get a job, so I'll start a startup. And then my question is, but when you look for a job, you maybe like send out 20 like CVs, right? When you're a startup, you have to do 100 a day at least. Yeah. And like my mentors are doing a couple of 1,000 a day. And like they're hitched to like big servers like Amazon and stuff like that, because the quantity of emails is just so big that you can't send it through a normal Gmail, and that, which is in this world, obviously, most know that this is lead generation. This is how the game is played, mm-hmm. And it's the quantity and quality. Because as you grow and you get to your 1,000, you'll be optimizing because you want that conversion rate to go up, right? You want to go from 2% to 4% to 8% to 12%. And the way you do that is by hiring a copywriter that does your copywriting better than you do, buying apps that make reminders easy for you, so that, which is what I used to do when I started. I had in my agenda, I had reminder days. So I would send out an email on a Monday, and then like probably on a Thursday, by the time I got through all the emails, I would start again this whole cycle of now sending reminder emails. And then like the next week again and again. And it's like, it takes like 4, 5, or 6 times before you even get a response. Mm. And then like, if you do it well, people will be happy, and if they're not interested, they'll just say no. If you do it bad, they'll start insulting you, which is something to learn. You can optimize as well.
So along those lines, how do you not appear pushy, yet still push hard enough to close the sale?
But then here's the question. If I take away all your money and there's no food on the table, will you be worried about pushy?
Probably not.
No, you'll be optimizing on the go and make sure that people don't insult you. And all my mentors that I've heard ever, they were always very arrogant in the beginning. Mm-hmm. I wasn't. I had to learn that arrogance from them. But like to a measure, like you try not to become arrogant, but you try to get the right balance, right? It's all about balance. But they all started really arrogant. Mm-hmm. Like I have stories from my mentors where they would insult the company in public, and the company would call them and they say, what did you do? Like so much traffic or bad name. And then the guy would just answer, okay, cool, so when are you hiring me? Yeah. And then I feel I'm a bit nicer when I do it. Mm-hmm. So pushy, if you're going with that mindset, then my answer to that is you're going as people like me that don't care. So how are you going to beat me if you're in the same industry when I just don't care, I just go for it, and I apologize if I insulted them in any manner, and try to do it with the best intentions, and I try to give them value, because if you're not giving them value and they're insulting you, then you're wasting their time, so you should optimize that, make better copywriting, give better value, like don't give them an ebook. Everybody has an ebook. Nobody cares about that ebook. Give them a video, like a nice video that's like, we looked at your company. That's what we saw wrong with it. We have the data to make this better. Hyros. Like, who's going to insult you for that?
Right. So how many employees do you have now in Lightning Video Editors?
We have a team. So I have two companies, and somehow they're still mixed. We're now 8 people, of which 6 are active because 2 are taking a break. And in Lightning Video Editor specifically, which is kind of a good thing, that's why I chose this industry as well, the industry got reformed a couple of years ago to the point where everybody was a freelancer, all my camera guys, all my editors. So I was in a very luxurious position because I could have a huge team and not have the fixed salaries, unless it was like a lot of projects and I had to do that. But yeah, so we don't have fixed, we have like 6 to 8 people because they don't take on a break. Mm-hmm. But 6 people that are just active, they're helping me, they're assisting me. But when we have big projects, I have a database between 50 to 80 people. Depending on the project, I would call them up and be like, these are guys that I've worked with for like 2-3 years now. So I know them, I know their gear, I know how the footage looks like, I know how they edit, they know how I edit. So in that sense, I'm in a luxurious position.
But from the 6 or 8 people there, that's more of your core team that you work together with on a regular basis. And how do you, when you, obviously you had to go from just yourself to the first person, second, third, fourth, how do you keep your I guess the culture, the mindset, the
So I tried. I really did try.
That's always something. It's always a challenge when you have an idea, you're passionate, you have maybe your co-founder. Like, oh, okay, now we need to hire our first person. Now what? Yes.
So the second company is Why Not 3. Mm-hmm. It's a work-life balance training program, and no matter how much changes I do, this company, the Work-Life Balance company, has a bigger vision than Lightning Video Editors. It's a video marketing. I try my best to only work with companies that have an experience worth sharing, and that's our headline, and we try to do the best. So we work with TEDx, we worked with those kind of companies. But still, it's corporate. Mm-hmm. And so even though I try my best, there are some limitations, even though I try to lift them by angling it towards something good. You can't fake something good. It has to be something good. So the companies I work with have to be good. And if I don't, my team starts giving me a lot of, like we have discussions. And it's not fixable because you're not authentic and you're suffering. In the other company, I learned what I was doing wrong here, which is the vision, the creation. Mm. And once that vision is really well done, you start attracting people. But attracting is not enough because now you have to build a hiring funnel to get the right people in. And once they're in, they're usually really high quality people because they're attracted to a vision where you improve people's lives. And then the real problem starts because a lot of people think, hey, getting them is no. So now you get really high quality people and they get bored after 3 to 5 months. So now culture starts where initially they were super motivated. The culture was no problem. Now it starts suffering, and I'm a very analytical person in the sense that I try to look and optimize systems and build systems. And then I get to the point where, how do you optimize culture if you're that kind of person? Mm. And so I was watching a video from Gary Vaynerchuk had just released a video of his chief heart officer. And I was like, wait, that's the missing link. I need a chief heart officer, a person that is the complete opposite of me, because I tried my best and I got to a point where people were just bored. They were going through the motions. It's not like they were bored. They saw the impact. People's lives were changing. But it's just, like, I couldn't do anything. I wasn't capable enough to do anything. So I got somebody, a chief heart officer, to do it. Okay. And she just... like, she messages now every day, like, what made you smile today? I would never really. It's just like, I would do it, but it's like, yeah. So
it's not something that you can do with an Excel sheet.
I tried. It will work for the first 3 months, and then it won't. So it's kind of the game of knowing your weaknesses and knowing your strengths. And then I like improving my weaknesses, but the way I like to do that is by having people that are way better than me lift me up instead of like fighting to get to to make my weakness a strength. So I'd rather just hire somebody who makes that better,
right?
Or ask somebody, a friend, like for free, to tell me like what do I do? A friend that is the complete opposite of me, like in this case, a girl that understands empathy a bit better than me, even though I try. But yeah.
So your second company, why not three? Can you tell us a little bit about that? Why? Where did the name come from?
The name.
So why not three? Why not four?
Exactly. Initially, I thought the number seven even, but well, the name is, as any name, just really simple. I was in the kitchen of a friend, and his mom was like making tea. They're British, and we were just chatting, and I was like, "Hey, I just came back." It was a German conference that I delivered the first workshop for Why Not Three. I was speaking there for other reasons. And this was this one external workshop that I came, and there was nobody. It wasn't allocated, so we just got it. The only message the agenda manager told us was, talk about work-life balance. And I was like, what kind of work-life balance? Like, what do you want? He said, just do your thing. And I was like, what thing? But eventually, I just looked at the workshop, and I thought, hey, let's just talk about the last three main principles that my mentors had taught me in how I managed the last 7 years going through law school, founding the companies, working with those 7-8 jobs, and maintaining all of that, and having relationships. And it was three simple principles that I thought, hey, cool, I'll just talk about that. Came back from that workshop, and the people there were, I realized how big the problems were in that moment. People were burning out, people were almost crying in the workshop. And I stood there and I literally thought, whoa, I thought I was just going to talk about three simple principles that everybody knows and we would do a refresh thing. And apparently nobody knew that. Mm. And so I came back and I was talking with this friend's mom. And I was like, all these people were so like this was the, I had workshops where I inspire people, but like this was a whole other level. And I was very lucky to discover that so young, to discover something where you can actually create an impact. That's crazy. And she was like, so I said, I want to write a pamphlet around it. And I started writing the pamphlet, and the pamphlet started becoming, like in the beginning, I thought it was 10 pages, like an output of the workshop. 10 pages became 20 pages, then 30, 40, 50. Soon became 100, and it, like, started becoming a book, to which extent I was like, how are we going to call this? And then she said to me initially, you're doing this thing, but you already have a business running. Why don't you just treat it the same way? That's what she said, treat it the same way. And I was like, that's when the light bulb came on. And I was like, wait a second, this work-life balancing, if I create it as a business, it would grow faster and spread the message faster. So now we needed to name it. And I was like, cool, yeah, okay, so what do I call the book? And then I heard somewhere, I think I read the blog post from Tim Ferriss on how he chose the title, The 4-Hour Workweek. And the way he chose it is pretty much, at the time it was Google Ads, I think it was doing. And he had a couple of headlines with the title of the book pretty much, and he would split test, and he got The 4-Hour Workweek. Hmm. So I went into the nearest bookstore, looked at self-help kind of industry, which is where my industry would be ending up. As any startup, if you start a startup, you need to do competitor analysis to know what's happening in that industry. So I went into the self-help sections, saw the books like Start With Why, The Compound Effect, The 4-Hour Workweek. And the one commonality that they all had was it was white and red. Like, it was just white and red, so I knew my colors now. And most of them had a question or they had a number. That I started seeing, like the books that popped up when you see them, those were the books with a number or with a question in them. And they were white and red. So I knew it had to be a question, it had to have a number, and it had to be white and red. So I was and I said that to her, and she's like, okay, so what kind of question? I was like, why don't we like do something like why? Like, why something? And then lucky number seven. So I was thinking, maybe why seven? She's like, why not three? And I was like, yeah, that sounds good. So that's how we got the title. And then the funny thing is, the moment she said that, I was like, yeah, that sounds good. And
it's catchy.
I took the pamphlet, the output that we had, and funnily enough, if you look at how I built the workshop, because I'm a certified trainer, so I build my workshops the way I was taught, and it was a 90-minute workshop, every principle, three principles, over 30 minutes each, and the book had three parts. And every part had three things. And one of the things, for instance, I'll share, which is what I talked about at TEDx, is how I define life. And the way I define life is based on a really underground pamphlet that almost nobody can find that I found when I was going through learning how to be more empathetic, more social with people. It was by a guy called Kenton Knepper on how to cold read people. So how to look at a person and in 80% of the cases, say something that sounds relevant to this person so that you create some comfort with this person so that you can start having real conversations. And he said that any and every problem that you ever have, you can divide into health, wealth, and relationships. And each has an internal and external component. So any problem falls under those three categories. And so to define life, I have three categories. Then the second principle also had three things in that. And the last thing also had three things. And it just fits. And then the Bader-Meinhof effect starts kicking in, which is the effect that, for instance, if you see a red Ferrari, you buy a red Ferrari, you see red Ferraris everywhere. So I started seeing the number three everywhere. And just it clicked, the name clicked. Mm. And I like that I didn't go with why three, but then why not three,
yeah.
It clicked as well.
No, it's a catchy name. So do you have the elevator pitch of why not three? What are the three, you know, you've been talking about three this, everyone's like, what is three?
Yeah.
So, but the elevator pitch version.
What we do is work-life balance.
What are the three topics? Yeah. Is work-life balance?
No, we do work-life balance for overachievers. So pretty much we get the most extreme cases of people that have burned out, doctors have given up on them, or like non-extreme cases that just don't know because there's a lot of crap out there. So they just don't know. And what I do in there, it was initially a platform where I say, this is how I learned it, and this guy, my mentor in this area, has taught me that. Or this guy. So that was kind of the idea of why not three.
And the three is the three topics that you refer to.
So in the workshop, in the masterclass, what I talk then about is in the first principle is how you define life. Why? Because when I first discovered it from Kenton Knepper, he was using it in a completely different industry. And I started using it in personal development because I had just figured out the relationships part. I felt comfortable. The foundations were laid for that. And I kind of was wondering, I learned a skill. What can I do next? Mm-hmm. And I was looking, at the time I had a door and like with chalk, I would write on it. And in the top left corner, because the door was filled, I just had HWR because I couldn't write the whole word. And I was like, what's next? And I'm looking at my door. I'm like, wait a second. I just figured out relationships. Maybe I can do like health or wealth. And at the time, I chose health. So I got into the whole biohacking community and like all my friends.
So the primary principles is that the health, wealth, and
health, wealth, and relationships. Yeah. So and the reason why it's important because once you know how to define life, you know where to put your focus to improve the basics and the foundation of that. The next part is I call this the meta level, the level where you rise above and you reflect on how it looks. So now you know where the problem is. Now you have to define how many goals you can handle. And I started experimenting with that. And you can research it. It's called the Warren Buffett method. It's how Warren Buffett divides his day. There, like a lot of people stuck their name on it. When I researched it, it was the Warren Buffett method. And pretty much what the guy said is like three goals. That's the maximum you can handle. And I was like, well, Warren Buffett is old, I can do better. So I started experimenting with more, and after like 6 months, I concluded that three was the maximum. And if with three goals, for instance, focusing on relationships, my girlfriend, for instance, or focusing on improving my business, or focusing, at the time, law school, if I do those three, I will improve in all areas. The moment I start taking four or five, so I put gym in there or something like that, suddenly I start maintaining stuff. Like it grows, but not as much, right. And it's more like a hustle. Like it's harder. So I did five, and it kind of works. I found a hack that I could combine stuff, which is my shortcut to it. But at the end of the day, to become truly successful, what I found was three. It was the three thing.
Focusing on three things at once.
Like and
so is work life balance possible?
Yeah. So the other myth around it is that I have a lot of discussions about with mid-level managers, and actually not the top, because the top realizes this, is you can have it, but just like starting a startup, when you can't find a job, it's going to be harder. If you decide to have a work-life balance, it's going to happen. Just like if you decide to be successful, think and grow rich, you'll get there somehow. You don't know how it'll look like, but you're not going to be ending up under a bridge or something like that. So the same thing with work-life balance. You have to decide first. And then the Bader-Meinhof effect kicks in. You start seeing stuff. And now that you start seeing stuff, you need the definition. What am I focusing on first? Because there's so much health, wealth, and relationships. So for instance, I went into health, right? And what you start realizing then is that you have to balance that. And to balance that, that's the last principle that I teach, is you have to go into the details of it. How do you plan your day? How does your day look like? How does your week look like? In detail. To the point where that's where the Excel sheet comes in. A friend of mine invented this Excel sheet that he coded called the Habit Sheet, which for my extreme clients, I use that because you need to know in detail what is happening there. Like in detail what their food is like, what their day is like, who they're talking to, everything. Because if you're at the top of your stress levels and you're almost ending up at the hospital, like at the time, that was my issue. It's the reason I got so extreme with it. I was diagnosed with chronic hyperventilation because of stress. The reason I'm breathing normally today is because I found a way to hit the optimal productivity point, but not go over it. And the reason I know I'm not over it is because the moment I go over it, and my friends around me can attest to that, I start breathing really bad. I start taking short breaths. I can't talk. Like, I can talk, I just don't notice. So I know right now that I'm balanced on the health side. It's really extreme, but I'm balanced on the health side because I'm not breathing bad. And the moment I feel that it's going there, so I catch my symptoms and know my body, I try to make sure that the systems that I've built so far are in check or if I'm lacking. And one of those systems is a thing that I invented called the silent day. Every Sunday I take a break. And if you have the discipline to build those systems and follow them no matter what, no matter what people say, because in the startup scene, if you tell them you take a break, like they'll shoot you. So, but I had to. So I took this silent day, and what I found is that I was more productive after. As long as I took that silent day every Sunday, it was like no matter what biohacking gear I got or what supplements I got, at the end, that was the thing that fixed me. And there's a really good book on it that I discovered later by Dr. John Gray, who describes the oldest tradition that we ever have written down in the Bible. It's the seventh day you take a break. And then suddenly now in the 21st century, with online kicking in, the seventh day vanished. It's really recent. And we started getting papers out from really renowned doctors about a disease called acquired attention deficit disorder, which is a real thing. And it's fixable if you read the book from Dr. John Gray, because if you just do a silent day, his silent day is based like on the Bible. Mine is way more strict, to the point where I detox, I don't eat, I do intermittent fasting, I don't have any electronics, I just pretty much lie in my bed. I made a video about it and everything, but because people didn't believe me that I actually don't do anything. Mm. So I made a video about it because they didn't believe me. And that's what usually fixes that. So is it possible? Yes, but it's a lot of discipline.
Right.
Because it's like a detox. Imagine going without your phone for a day if you're a top-level executive that has like 10,000 fires to put out. But it's possible. And the top-level executives that make it and are happy, they do it. And they do meditation. They do all that fun stuff. But it's not easy. Right. It's definitely not easy.
So what advice would you give a young you if you could go back and say, little Lova?
I don't know. the thing is, I don't have any regrets. I'm happy with the way it went, mm-hmm. and I'm happy with every step that I took, because every hardship that I had gave me material for Why Not 3, where I can inspire people. Or it's not really inspire. I have trackers and systems based on those bad experiences that I give to my clients now to fix them. So if I didn't have any of those bad experiences, I wouldn't know how to get out of them. And bad experiences could include things like when I was lonely and I didn't have family, I didn't have friends, and I had to build everything from zero because I wanted to be in law school and I wasn't going to go work somewhere because I believed that I could have done more if I had an education. And how I got out of those slumps, out of those negative thoughts, mm-hmm. what did I do and attract myself at the time? Was it, for instance, I discovered that the main thing to get me out of that almost depression, what it was, is talking, being social with people, but not social for the sake of knowing somebody, but actually like...
Getting to know someone.
One of those things when you're at the top, right? And I have a video testimonial on my website from one of my clients where he says it perfectly. When you're at that level, like CEO, or you're a founder or startup, and when you're even like small but you're alone, it gets depressing, like really bad. And especially if you're in charge of everything, when it goes bad, it's your fault. And you are there in your mind, and everybody has those voices where it's like, it's your fault, it's your fault. Why did you do this decision, not that decision? Especially when it goes bad, and it will go bad. So the negative voices come in. How do you get out of that slump? And the simplest things are the ones that get you out of it. And so I tracked it, and there are a ton of it. Like, there are a ton of biohacks that you can do. You can take supplements. Like, psychiatrists give you antidepressants, right? Which is crap. You shouldn't do that. But the most effective was the simplest thing. It's talking to somebody that listens to you. So really simple, what do I do when I have a top-level executive client? I just listen. It's like one of those things. I listen, they know that they're heard, and it does so much. It's crazy, it does so much. So
anyway. And if anyone has a question at any point in time, just raise your hand. We have a microphone here. We'll pass that around. Happy to take your questions as well. So I guess back a little bit to the business side of things. Let me see where we have the microphone. There we go.
Hi, my name is Victoria, and you mentioned that you had mentors for your business. I was curious to see how those mentors came into your life, how you started asking them for that commitment, and any advice you could give us for people we know that we think would be good mentors, and how can we encourage them to give us their time if they're busy?
It's like the most demanded question, which I love. I love that because it's important to know. So thank you for asking, because I think it can bring value. I literally got an email this morning from one of the members that follows my 30-day challenge, and he asked that. And I answered, just follow the 30-day challenge I explained in there. But no, my actual answer to that is there are two ways, because I tracked it, right? So there are two ways in my mind, my subjective mind, how I got it. There's the non-paid way, and there's a paid way. I prefer the paid way because of the fact that dynamics change. And if they're a good mentor, they will go above and beyond to make you successful. So I like the paid way. The paid way could be in different ways. It could be paying to go to Startup Grind, right? Being around these people, finding somebody more successful than you, just chatting with them, getting around their circles. You'd be surprised how many of my friends, my mentors, my clients, pay sometimes up to 20, 30,000 euros just to go on some retreat to be around some millionaires. Just to be around them. It's not guaranteed that those people are even clients. It's just being around them. And how many times I have a story in my book how when I was a student, I had almost nothing on my bank account, but I was working based on commission door to door. I just got that job. And I put the deposit down to find my mentor, to go to a workshop that my mentor had in New York. And I was a student, barely had any money, no support, had some job for a charity where I was doing door-to-door, put the money down. In that, like, because there was so much stress there, within 2 months, I broke the national record, which gave me the money to fund the rest of the trip to New York and be around this person. And so now I'm around in the circles. He's my Facebook friend. And I just chat sometimes. I'm, like, sending him messages. Hey, this super cool thing happened with me. Thank you. But I keep him in mind. That's the paid way, how I got in there. And when people tell me, I don't have enough money to do that, like, I was broke. I didn't have anything, and I did that. And I have people telling me stories how they save up, like, 1.5K to go to some Australia trip or something like this. Like, you can also go to a mentor. So that's the paid way. I prefer that way because it creates a better dynamic, I feel. Well, sometimes. It's a subjective way, right? So being around events, being around specific people. The cheap way is, when I was completely broke, how I did it, is YouTube, Google, blogs, books, audiobooks. There's a ton on YouTube, audiobooks that you can find. And you digest all of their content. And that's actually a good way to start. Because so I digested all of the content that my mentor had before I even went to New York. So that by the time I went to New York, the questions that I had were very specific and targeted. To the point where he taught me, he was at the time number one in the world for social dynamics. He taught me how to predict behavior, which is something I wouldn't even have guessed was possible because he never talked about it. Because of the fact where I got thanks to his free content, I was ready to receive that advanced level content from him at the time. If I didn't follow the cheap way, the free way, which is absorbing everything from YouTube, from books, audiobooks, everything, then this wouldn't have worked as well. But this would get me around him, which is important, so that I could then read the books and then still ask the question. But the cheap way is literally everything's online. And, like, very simple. In Why Not 3, I made the rule that if it's super unless it's super expensive, it's free. So people ask me, how can I get around you as a mentor, blah, blah. Everything is there. And then really big guys, like there's, like I've heard about Dan Pena, which is a really cool guy, right? But all of his content, he literally says it, is online for free in written form. And in videos, he shares like a little bit. So it, like, all of them give away content for free, and they have to. It's a marketing tactic. Because if your content isn't good and it doesn't give you results, then why would they buy a course from you? So you can learn so much by taking the free content, applying it, free content, applying it. To the point, like, and this is the analogy that I give in the video in the 30-day challenge, is once you hit that point, like in the gym, you're exercising, and you hit that point where it's like too much. Like, you're trying everything, but you're not gaining muscle mass. And with start, like, business, you're trying everything, but you're stuck at the 5K a month level. At that point, you've hit a limit of yourself. And what you do then is what the second option is. You get around people that have gone through that hurdle. And there are several ways, like I said, to get around those people. You pay for events, or you pay for specific mentors. And that it's like, it's so real that it's so weird to me that startups don't even understand that. Because if you have a problem in the film industry, none of the billionaires are going to help me because they don't know film industry. But some guy next to me down the street that also does film in the same office, I pay him, like, I don't know, 500 euros or 1,000 euros for an hour. And, like, I know the guy now, and every time I have a problem, I ask him, or I pay him 1,000 euros for an hour, and I say, this is my problem. Like, what do I do? And you get through the hurdle. And as you do that, you build networks of people that know people, that are interesting, that can help you, that are relevant to you. And then it's about maintaining. So now you maintain the relationship. So you don't just, it's kind of like dating a girl. You don't just, like, sleep with a girl and then leave. I mean, you can do that, but it's not beneficial, right? Unless you're that person. But in a business relationship, it's not. You treat this person with respect by staying in touch with this person and giving them kind of, they taught you something, you sent them a message back, hey, I applied it, and I got like 10K now, not 5K. And that's how you stay in their mind. And then when something big pops up, you're not paying 1K anymore. They'll help you for free.
So, can I just add a little quick thing? Sorry. Do you have a list of these mentors as official mentors of your company? Or are they just sort of people you can reach out to when you need to?
Like, as in official men, there are no official mentors. It's like me on a YouTube channel saying, this guy helped me with this, this guy. So I have like specific people that I know 100%, like these guys just, their content is good. I've applied it. It worked for me. So why would I refer to somebody else? So for business, I do that. For health, it's a bit harder because health is very, like, it's hard. And it's hard because it's individual. So there are guys like Tim Ferriss, Dave Asprey, and Mark Sisson. They're the main guys. The issue with health that we recognize is, and we got certified by a laboratory called ALCAT. So we got the option now to do blood tests on our clients to see how their immune system reacts to certain types of foods. So it becomes harder for me to refer to a Dave Asprey or Mark Sisson or whatever, and they're amazing people and they have amazing content, but it doesn't work for everybody. And it doesn't work because it has to be in certain doses. Certain fats have to be in certain doses for other people. And for instance, some people are better on dairy. Europeans are way better on dairy than on the other side of the ocean. So in that point, it became hard to refer to other people just because we became kind of more individualistic and more, thanks to ALCAT, we became more centered on that. So I do refer and I do still say these guys are really good because they teach you the mentality on how you should treat health. You can learn it from me, but if you don't believe me, you can still go to these people and see that they do the exact same thing as I do, and in some extents, even way more than I do, because they're also older. They have more years, more experience. But sometimes it becomes harder, but I still mention them.
Thanks. Hi. So I find it very interesting, everything you do, and I applaud you, and I think, as you said, balance is the key. So I want to ask you, out of curiosity, because we just talked, so with 17, I thought I knew it all, and I was like, I know it all. Now I'm 32, and I know even less. So do you think with 23, you have enough experience to say that you know what it takes to balance life, work, and health? And also the second question is, how do you make CEOs, for example, who are 60 or 65, trust a 23-year-old telling them how to balance their life?
Well, a simple answer is results. Yeah. Again, some guys that are huge don't have the certifications that we have, so they're very individualistic. But realistically, do I know? Of course not. And that's why I build a platform where I refer to my mentors.
But the book you wrote, right? Not your mentors. Like, who wrote the book?
Who wrote the book?
Yeah, you.
Oh, in the book, yeah. I also refer to people.
Okay.
Just like I studied law, just like in a law paper, you refer to sources that are way smarter than you, have done their research and have applied it and it works. Just in this book, I do the same thing. It's the mentality of law. And so in the book, I refer to people that are way smarter than me, have done way more time or research than I ever in my lifetime could do. So I don't know anything, and that's why I would rather build the platform where I refer to the people that have taught me. And I say have taught me, not know everything, because I've applied their knowledge and it seems to work for me. So I think it can work for them too. And that's why I refer to them. And what I share in my platform is how I did it. So that you can go to those sources, see what they preach, and then see how I applied it. Because there's a big chance that you'll apply it differently. But it's nice to know how somebody did it, because it's very vague most of the time. How do I get guys that are way older than me to trust me? Well, first of all, on that level, there aren't many people that understand the psychology of that high performance. I got lucky because of my experience. Lucky was chronic hyperventilation. It's not that lucky, but it's like I went through a really bad experience, and most of the time, it's worse than any of the CEOs that I get, no matter how chronic their diseases are. Unfortunately, somehow I got it worse. Luckily, in some ways it's not as bad because it's not like I got a guy that's really overweight. So fortunately, I didn't have that. So in some ways it's worse, in some ways it's better. But what it does give you, just like, it's kind of like, I studied psychology a little bit, it's kind of like a war survivor or somebody that got shot. It doesn't matter if you got shot by a Glock or by an M16, you got shot, it's the same thing. The experiences are different, but you understand each other. And once you're on that wavelength where you understand each other, it doesn't matter the age, it matters the experience and if you found a solution. And the reason I help them is not because I want to help them and I see the money in it. No, it distracts me, because one of the things that you learn in startups is you focus on one thing and you do that till the rest of your life, right? And this kind of distracts me from that. But as one of my mentor once said when I was going for my certification for a trainer, is he said, when your audience displays a need, you have to do it. Because you're there in a leadership capacity. And a leadership capacity to me means that you have to sacrifice your needs for their needs in any shape or form, because that's how you help them. So everywhere I looked, all these top performers, you know what they were saying is do more, work more, do 18 hours, do 20 hours. And you know, when you really look deeper into them, and like I would challenge any huge CEO to that, when you really look deeper into what they actually do, it's not 18, 20 hour days. They do them some, like most of the times even, they do 18 to 20 hours. You know what they also do? They take 2 week breaks. They sometimes between those 18, 20 hours, they take 2 hours where they go to their families. Nobody mentions that part. Nobody mentions that they sometimes even meditate. Nobody mentions that outside of all of that, they go running with their friends in the mornings or to the gym. It kind of gets mentioned, but it doesn't get emphasized. So when I built a platform, it wasn't going to be called productivity. It was going to be called work-life balance. Because what we actually do is optimal productivity in each area. But if I would call it optimal productivity, it would have the wrong connotation to what actually is getting done. And nobody was talking about work-life balance, and it had to be spread. Because the actual successful, happy people, they all balance. But that message doesn't get spread. And in some way, I had the luxury position to work with multinationals. So I get a first view in Lightning Video Editors how those guys actually do it. But in startups, there isn't that much chance that you're going to see that. So like I said, what I preach is what I discovered. There are some things that I invented and some things that I applied from my mentors. I refer to everybody, because I have to from my law background. My professors wouldn't be happy. But I refer to everybody. I show how I apply it. And it's not my knowledge, so it doesn't matter what my age is. It's somebody's knowledge that has dedicated his life to it. And go to there and read that book or see how I apply it. And yeah, at the end of the day, it's just there is a need. And the need is those people are burning out. They're ending up in hospitals. Nobody's speaking up about it. Nobody at that level is speaking up about it.
What do you mean at that level? For example,
Founding companies that are successful. The people that are founding companies that are successful, I know because like they're my friends, they don't want to talk about it. They want to be anonymous. They don't have an online presence. Sometimes they do have an online presence. But at the end of the day, they just want to do business. There are people like me, analytical Excel sheets. They want to optimize systems. But when you have best friends ending up in the hospital and yourself almost getting chronic hyperventilations, almost ending up in hospitals. At one point, I had paralysis of my limbs just because of stress. And when all of that is happening and you fix yourself and then your friends, the doctors are giving up on them. Nobody wants to take care of them. And you take care of them, you start realizing, and then when that workshop popped up and these people are almost crying in my workshop, it's like, holy, nobody's doing this. It's crazy.
But what do you mean nobody's doing it? Because there's so many like Anthony Robbins, etc.
But Anthony Robbins, yeah. What does he actually say? He's a success coach. Productivity is his main thing. But what he actually does, if you zoom in, is work-life balance.
Yeah, exactly.
So why didn't he call it work-life balance? But you know, just like that experiment when you're in small grade, you talk into somebody's ear, and by the time it reaches the other room, somebody gets watered down. You look at Anthony Robbins, and if you don't see his day-to-day, you think productivity, I have to work more. Anthony Robbins is running around for 20 hours on a five-day conference. I have to do more. You don't actually see what Anthony Robbins does, how much time he spends with his kids, with his family. He actually takes breaks. He talks about meditation and how he optimized that. But you know what I realized from me and from normal people like me? You do that for 6 months, and then you're like, ah, screw it, I'll just eat chocolate. So it's like, that's not maintainable. That's not a system that will keep you healthy. If in some way, in the best way, I hope Anthony Robbins at one point rebrands himself and says, work-life balance, that's what you should do. And he says all the time, and he emphasizes, like I emphasize, relationships and health and business all the time. Instead of, he emphasizes business a bit more because that's what he gets and that attracts some money, of course. But if he does that, there will be a spread. And it's happening. It's happening. Arianna Huffington started doing that, which is good. But again, this is like, what, one person? Whereas you have other people that get more attraction that are saying 20-hour days. Hey, let's all do that. But those 20-hour days, they have good families. They didn't go through what I went through, which is actually really common among founders. Loneliness, not having a family to back them up, not having friends, sickness. And if you say 20-hour days, then you're going to end up in the hospital, not within 2 years. 2 years you can maintain, 5 years. At the five-year mark, I tracked it. At five-year mark, that's when the symptoms start showing up, and you can't go back anymore. It's done. It's a trauma. So that's the reason I did it.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So I think we could probably go on a lot longer, but we need to wrap up. You're still around for a bit afterwards. So if you have any questions for Lova, he's still around. We have another 45 minutes for networking. And I'm sure he'd be happy to connect with you personally as well. But before we wrap up, we'd like to ask a few questions we ask to all of the guests that we have here. We call it rapid fire questions. So there's just simple, fun questions.
Okay.
And the first thing that comes to mind is what we want to hear.
Okay.
So what is an item that you own that you would never sell?
That I would never sell? My HeartMath device, which is an infrared tracker that measures your heart rate variability. I don't use it. I would never sell it.
And what is your most unusual skill?
My most unusual skill? I'm not creative. I'm in the film industry, I'm not creative. Is that a skill?
It's interesting.
Yeah.
What's more important, strength, speed, or stamina?
Definitely not strength, because strength over time develops. Speed is everything. But over time, stamina will make you successful. So it's like, if you are slow but you have stamina, that's not a good combination. But if you have speed and stamina, then yes. If you have speed and no stamina, you'll burn out.
What historical figure do you most admire?
I like Isaac Newton, because of how smart he was. Historic person that I like right now who's really popular is Neil deGrasse Tyson, the scientist, really cool guy. Good content on YouTube.
And what is your favorite season of the year?
Spring, because it's warm, but not too warm, and you don't sweat.
And when was the last time you tried something new?
Something new. I think it was the other week. What did I do? Oh yeah, it was a new system to learn faster.
Not the one with the headphone. It's like, hey, yeah. Talk about. If you could have the attribute of any animal, what would you choose?
The attribute of any animal. like the long age of a turtle.
Very cool. Thank you so much, Lopa.